Netflix film feature today. Please join me in welcoming the man who I've worked with for years. I mean, the man, I got shot up with like 700 bullets in Street Kings with this man. Please welcome director David Ayer back to Hall H. It's my homie. Man, right here.
What's up? What's up? Hall H. This is the house of Netflix. This is Netflix right now. We're here to represent Netflix. What's up with that?
Netflix house, boy. Netflix house, bitch. Okay. Oh boy, I think I went over. I think I won't be back. But now, please welcome the producers, Eric Newman and Brian Uncleness. Now, man, you are not gonna believe this, lady. This woman can kick some serious ass. Please welcome Nomi Rapace. Incredible. Now, in bright, he is a federal agent on a mission. Please welcome Edgar Ramirez. An amazing young actress who holds her own against Will and Joel in the film. Please welcome Lucy Fry. Now watch out, Andy Serkis. This actor completely disappears into his role. The brilliant Joel Edgerton. And please give it up for my man, the biggest movie star in the world, the incomparable Will
Terry heard you playing.
I'm so sorry. Don't sue me, please. David, do you have something to show us right now?
I brought a little something with me, so you guys are going to be the first people on the planet to see this new trailer for Bright, so check this shit out, all right? Let's take it up.
Woo! Listen, wow. Man, I'll tell you, Dave, now you and I go back, literally training day, harsh times, Street Kings, nobody does West Coast grit like David Ayer.
Yeah, that's real.
Real. Jan, please tell us about the storyline to Bright.
You know, it's about LA. It's about a really fucked up LA, but our world's fucked up, you know? And that's what's pretty cool about this movie is I get to explore some really interesting social issues. You know, this is a world where orcs and elves and fairies are real, you know, and magic is real. And what happens if we take it seriously? And this isn't like some bullshit PG-13 standard issue studio movie. I mean, this is like, I was able to do my shit here, right? I was able to really tell a fucking story, okay? I was able to like do my thing. And these actors with me, I mean, they absolutely killed it, you know? So you haven't seen this before. This is a new kind of thing we're doing.
Yeah, wow. Yeah. Now let's talk about your re-team with your Suicide Squad homie, Will Smith.
Yeah!
Tell us about your character.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I play Detective Ward, you know, and it was like such a beautiful thing to be able to get back with Dave, and especially in this opportunity. It is such a bizarre world. I mean, I'm sure you can tell a little bit from the trailer, but it's this crazy mashup of like the grit and that hard rated R grime of you know, Training Day, like that kind of vibe, but then smashed with Lord of the Rings. You know? Yeah, it's like, it's this really spectacular world. And, you know, at the center of the story is, you know, my character Ward with Joel's character, and Joel plays an orc, and his character is the first orc on the LAPD. So it just felt really great, you know, to be an African-American police officer that just found, you know, somebody else to be racist against. You know, I just don't, you never get to be on that side of racism when you're black. You know?
It's like, look, man, I don't want no orcs in my car.
But no, it's great to have this size of a spectacular world, but then to really narrow the story down to something really simple and human as a foolish prejudice. You know, it was really beautiful.
Now, Joel, give it up. Joel, I am a major fan of you. I mean, from warrior to loving. I mean, you have this ability. Yeah.
Yeah.
He has this tremendous ability to just really encapsulate a character. Please tell us about your character here in Brian.
Well, the great thing about transforming for this character is when someone puts a couch on your face.
Yeah.
Which is what I called my makeup, because it's made of foam. It's impossible not to transform. I read this script and I was so in love with a character who, you know, I love Lord of the Rings. The idea of playing an orc who is trying desperately to be as much like a human being as possible. A conservative human being who almost does not understand irony, wit, or any kind of humor, which Will brings in spades, and I think it brings...
Spades. It's racist. It's spades. That's racist. That's racist. It's everywhere. It sneaks up on us everywhere, folks.
We have a deeply racist dynamic, back and forth. The idea that I'm playing a guy who just really wants to be liked and yet looks like a monster. I gotta tell you though, driving around downtown LA in a car with the windows open and no lockdown streets, and I'm looking like I look in the movie, The Power of Will Smith. Nobody cares that a monster was driving the car. They're like, Will!
LA! Will! LA!
Will! Who cares that his chauffeur is a monster?
LA don't give a damn.
I feel a bit upset, actually, to be honest.
Now, know me. I'll tell you, you scared me. You scared me in this
place. Yeah.
First of all, I have never seen a badass female villain like this. You have never seen anything like this in your life.
Yeah.
You are not ready. I'm trying to tell you. I'm very scared right now. So, what was your preparation like? What was that?
Well, I did a lot of fight training. David always wants his actor to come in and do like a long like preparation period. So I did a lot of fight training, a lot of shooting. I was out in the shooting range, shoot like big guns, small guns. And then I was, and I had to try to learn how to move in really high heels and a tight suit, gloves, rings, jewelry. It was a lot. And then contact lenses, elf ears, teeth. It was like everything that makes it really hard. But on the day, it was amazing how I just, I love my character, and she seems to be evil and quite brutal, but from my perspective, she was doing, she was fighting for a better world. Like, she's trying to create something beautiful, but her method is quite vicious sometimes. I loved her. She was...
And the elves are the best dressed.
We are above. We're like the peak.
Yeah. It's like this world, you know, it's a little bit about the divisions in life, you know, but in this case, you know, the elves are like the 1%ers. They run the world. They dress very nice. They get all the dealer samples. The humans are kind of in the middle management, and then the orcs are the workers, are the guys that dig ditches and build your houses and build your roads, you know, but they don't really get any respect, and they get their ass kicked by the cops all the time, so.
Oh. Yeah, now it's a really beautiful hierarchy like that in the film, and, you know, David did a really great job, and Max Landis, the original screenplay also, is such a... a beautiful snapshot of our world, you know, without hammering on it too much. And you just see all of the layers and the people and all of the different issues. And at the end of the day, everybody's really just trying to have a good life, you know, but then it turns into Bright.
You will never look at the Keebler elf the same way.
Yeah, right.
No.
Ever. Yeah, them elves will get you. Them elves will get you.
Now, Eric and Brian, how do you create an incredible world that you built here in Brighton?
Oh, we spent a lot of money. I look at that and I start to sort of sweat. In reality, we beginning with a great script from Max Landis and David's outstanding leadership, every artist on the film in front of and behind the camera really cared about this movie and the world, and they understood it. And we went very deep in it, talking about how this happened and the different races and how they've gotten along, how they haven't gotten along. And you know, it really is about that level of commitment that across the board, and we just took it incredibly seriously.
Yeah, you know, working with David makes it a lot easier. He's so authentic. And especially shooting in LA, I mean, David is really good at finding disgusting locations.
Yeah.
We were a lot of alleys with a lot of cockroaches and rats. That really helps.
Yeah. Actually, you guys were at the monitors, and we were in the alley with cockroaches.
That's true.
I remembered a little differently.
We had a different experience. That is true. But, you know, Comic-Con is really, for most of us, one of the very few times we actually get to do our jobs in California. So to be able to shoot a film and to take advantage of the California subsidy, it's huge.
Yeah, sure.
You cannot shoot Los Angeles in Atlanta. You can't do it. So
but
it's actually great.
You know, it has a lot to do with, I think, how Netflix does their business is, you know, they let you be a filmmaker and they're like, what's the best place to shoot this movie? And I'm like, Los Angeles, fine, we're gonna do it.
Done.
They gave me all the tools, they gave me all the resources. They let me be creative. You know, you can ask the actors, the environment on set, it was like an independent movie. It felt like I was making, you know, my first film, Harsh Times or something. It was just a lot of love on set and a lot of support from Netflix, and they really let me have my voice, and they gave the actors space, and they gave us space to make something really incredible. And that may not quite land with you guys. You have to understand what the opposite is and sort of what the real situation is out there with a lot of filmmakers. And I think Netflix is going to pull a lot more talent because they are so supportive. They all are supportive of the process. It feels like it's 20 years ago with them. It's kind of amazing.
Yeah.
It was like one day I came to set. I've been rehearsing this long fight sequence. First day on in this location, amazing location, smelled quite bad though, but it was amazing. And then David is like, okay, I wanted to come running over this like strip, it's like a strip stage, right? Like, he was like, I wanted to come running and like fly through this glass wall and then start to fight. And everyone is like quiet, it's like, okay. And then we did it. That's him. And that, you know, in this environment with Netflix and the way they worked, it was amazing that we could do, that it could be so playful. And so
it was a journey. I mean, we found the movie as we went, and it's so rare to be able to do that. I mean, this movie really took on its own shape, and I can't wait for you guys to see this on December 22nd. I'm very proud of this, and I'm so proud of the work that these guys did.
David, can you introduce the clip we're about to see right now?
Yeah, so elves are stronger than people. They're a little bit quicker. They live longer. They have much better credit scores.
Better looking.
Better looking. And when they're pissed off at you, watch out. Let's roll it.
Somebody right here. It's now time for our audience questions, please. And we come with the first question.
Whoa.
Hi, buddy. Uh-oh.
Hey, guys. Thank you all. Thank you all for coming, especially you, Will.
Oh, man.
I love you.
That's a little pleasure, man.
Big fan of all you guys. Question is for David. Huge fan of your work. I just was wondering, usually you work in a more grounded real world setting, and just wondering, working in the world of fantasy, if you felt like it was more challenging or liberating adapting the social commentaries in this film of like togetherness and living together.
You know, it was an interesting process because what's different about this movie is is it takes itself seriously. You know, the characters in the movie, yeah, it's like there's elves, orcs, and all that. They still have to pay their bills. They still want to be happy. They still get married. They still have kids. Everybody's still leading their lives. But there are the social issues. There is a stratification. There is limited mobility. And how do you deal with that? And it's a fantastic way to look at those issues today without, you know, beating people over the head with it, because sadly some people just don't want to hear it. You know, they don't want to know what's going out there in the real world, you know, and this is a world of walls, and it's a world of segregation, and unfortunately, hey man, you know, we're living it right now, so what the fuck.
Hey, wait, hold on before we go to the next. This is Lucy Fry's first Comic-Con, and you know, it's her first movie and first talk show, and you know, Hall H, you know, she knows Hall H is like the big one, so she was terrified. So I just wanted to personally just introduce you all to Lucy Fry, and let's give her some love and some support. There you go. Lucy! And y'all, we love Edgar. You all know Edgar. And he's so handsome. Sorry, go ahead. I didn't mean to hijack your show, man.
It's all good, no. You know? Your show, it's your show. I'm just here to navigate. Yes, sir, next question.
Hi there, my question's for Will. You've done a couple sci-fi and fantasy movies now. What about these genres? No? what about these genres keeps bringing you back?
You know, when I guess I was probably 10 years old or something like that when Star Wars came out. And I got like, I've never been smashed like that in a movie theater. It was like, my mind was boggled, you know? And that was, you know, for this generation, you've already seen magnificent things in movies and the special effects and what people can do. But when Star Wars came out, that it was impossible. Like there weren't special effects, you couldn't do that. So it's like, we were just completely blown away. And for my entire life, I've been chasing, trying to give that feeling to fans. It's like there was nothing that I had ever experienced in my life that matched that point of ecstasy. And I had sex a few years later, and that was pretty, it was close. I mean, close, but no Star Wars, you know, so.
Question.
Hey, I just want to say, Will, what's up, man?
Hey, man, what's up? How you doing?
Good. First off, I love the Suicide Squad.
Thank you.
And my question is for you, is this your first Netflix movie?
Yes. This is my first Netflix movie. The first, it's really interesting to be at the, you know, the forefront of whatever this new way to consume entertainment is gonna be. I know there's been a big debate about that, but I mean, I am extremely excited to see where this thing goes. You know, there's been a lot of debate about it, but I have a 16-year-old, a 19-year-old, and a 25-year-old at home, and the films they go to the theater to see and the films they watch on Netflix don't necessarily cross. They go to the movies every weekend, and they, you know, watch films at home during the week. So you know, I don't know how it's going to be played out, but I'm really excited to see how it goes.
How many of you out here have Netflix? How many of your subscribers? Let me hear it.
Yeah!
All right, I think there's like two dudes out there, so just give them like your passcode or something. All right.
Give me a luggage.
Hey, what's up again, Terry?
What's up again?
What up? Hey, everybody, love all of you. Everybody's just showing all the love to Will, but it's Will, that's why.
Aww.
But my question
is... It's the ears.
You look cute.
Yeah, like the people love the ears.
Why not? My question is for you, like, kind of correlates what you were just talking about. What is the difference between shooting like a Netflix film versus like a big, like Paramount picture or something?
Right. Well, there's no difference in the shooting. other than the process that you know, like David was saying, at Netflix, I'm sure this will end soon, but they like give you money and let you go make the movie you want to make. So it's like, that's fantastic. But you know what? There is a difference between seeing a movie in the theater and seeing it on Netflix. So it is a different thing, but it's a different thing the way it was a different thing, you know, in the early days of film when you were on stage and there were stage plays, and then you went from stage plays to filmed entertainment. So you know, so it's definitely a difference, but there's a different medium. The thing I can say is when I was on the Fresh Prince of Bel Air. Yeah! It's really funny because most of you weren't born when that show actually was on. you were, you know. You know, so it's Lucy had never seen it. Lucy had never seen it. No, she had seen every episode now. I introduced her, you know, but she was like, she's from Australia too, though, so. But anyway, so I was on The Fresh Prince, and you know, it was great. People would see me on the street, and they would say, Will, hey, Will. And then Independence Day came out. And that Monday, after Independence Day came out, was the first day anybody ever referred to me as Mr. Smith, right? So there's something about that big screen that does something in people's minds that is different. There is definitely a difference, but I don't think that it's a competitive difference. It's a difference that will, you know, flow and harmonize and actually expand the fans' ability to enjoy filmed entertainment.
I agree.
Next question.
Hey guys, my name's Keon, and my question's directed for David, no pun intended. So David, what's been your favorite part about working with Will?
Whoa.
I mean, you're seeing it right now. He's a good dude, you know? It's, you know, we got a great relationship. We've learned to really trust each other, and he has, you know, such a history as an actor, as a film actor. He has incredible instincts, and we sort of work together where I'm weak, he's strong. I think he's strong everywhere, but it's we guide each other, and we find things, I think, that normally you wouldn't find if you didn't have that relationship.
Yeah, trust is a big part in the actor-director relationship, you know, because, you know, David asks you to do weird shit sometimes.
You know? I've been there.
You've been there, yeah, right. You want me to do what? Come on, man, I got kids. You know? But you know, you definitely knew me. Yeah, you know about that.
I know. This really speaks for what a great man he is. One day, he was off camera for, I think, 8 or 9 hours. They were on me. They turned on him like 3 in the morning. And he was like in such a good mood. And I was like watching this man, like one of the biggest stars we have in the world, not complaining, just giving so much love and support to me for this like entire night. And then they turned on him, did 2 takes, and it was a wrap. That says everything about him.
Edgar, what was your experience working with David?
Well, David, first of all, I'm very happy to be here. It's my first Comic-Con as well. So, very, very excited. David speaks flawless Spanish. He speaks Spanish very well. I'm not from Connecticut, as you can tell. And he would, because he does these things, you know, he gets into your head, and the things that he knows about you, then he use them in a way that would create the best opportunities for you to bring new inputs to the character. And then he would direct me the entire movie in Spanish. And then I would translate to the crew and to the other actors what he was telling us to do, because he wanted to create that utterly, you know, like, world. You know what I mean? The world that was completely out of context. So those are the kind of things that... And of course, we got away with some stuff. However, in California, you can, not that much, because a lot of people do speak Spanish, so all that I mean is there, you know? But that's some of the things that he does, yeah.
Now, Lucy, what is a bright? Can you explain to us what a bright is?
A bright is a magic user. And my character is in possession of the ancient relic, this wand, that normally brights use this wand. And I can't tell too much about it because Tika's kind of like a big bag of secrets. And if I say too much, then it spills the beans. But yeah, the bright is a magic user, and when Ward and Jacoby find the wand that Tika has, that's sort of when everything unravels and we're running away from Noomi's character.
Yeah, in the movie, if a human were to touch a magic wand, they would just obliterate themselves. You have to be trained in magic to actually handle a wand. And Tika's character, she's like a baby bright, a little baby bright. She's been trained, and you know, we find ourselves in this situation. Numi's character is a real full-on bright, but she lost the wand. And
I was throwing the wand inside of my arm. It's a piece of my body.
Yeah, that's sexy.
Right there. That's a whole nother movie right there.
Next question.
Corwin, and I want to say, Terry, you're awesome.
Oh, thank
and you should have gone to Doomfist. You really should have. And Will Smith, you're awesome also.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
For the director, did you get your thought process from Shadowrun by any chance? And if you did not, where'd you get your whole entire thought process for the whole entire movie with all these different elves and orcs and everything else?
It came from a fantastic script that Max Landis wrote. Tito has been a fan of mine, and he actually dedicated the script to me. And I never read anything. I never read scripts. And my agent's like, dude, you got to read this, bro. And I read it, and I'm like, okay, I'm in. Let's do it. It's this sort of genius combination of this lore, this traditional lore, and what I do so well as a director about telling stories about Los Angeles and law enforcement and friendship and honor and respect and all these things. And Max really found a vision that I hadn't seen before in the movie. So I had a lot of fun making this film.
Wow, all right. Now that's our end of our audience questions, but Will, what are we about to see now?
So Edgar just pointed out, and it said, welcome to Comic-Con. Please be aware that many of the members of your audience may be under 18 years of age.
The whole wrong situation is out of control.
Yes, I'd like to apologize to any of the parents in the audience. I didn't read that till just now, so I was just... like to apologize for the wand comment.
Sorry about the F-bombs. This should be printed larger.
They got to make it. Yeah, I'm just seeing it now, and this is terrible. This is terrible. I talked about having sex as a teenager. Like, this is crazy. I blame Comic-Con.
It's your fault.
It's right at the top. I just saw that. Sorry. But before we go, I know we have to go. But I want to see the trailer one more time because it was like close on me. So I want to come out there a little bit to be able to see it. All right, so let's roll the trailer one more time. Thank y'all. Comic-Con. Thank you.
Thank you.